It's time to talk about as we review MLEM from Rebel Studio, who we have to thank for sending us this meme-inspired dice chucker.
MLEM Space Agency was designed by Reiner Knizia, a name most board game fans are going to know pretty well. It features some rather striking artwork, odd for a Knizia game, from Joanna Zepetska. It was just released earlier this week. How's that for new hotness for you from us? By our friends at Rebel Studio.
This competitive push-your-luck dice game plays 2 to 5 players and is better the more people play. Games take about an hour at the highest player counts, getting shorter with fewer players. As a family weight game, this one is good for gamers of all ages, though younger kids may need a bit of help with some of the strategy involved.
In MLEM, players will be sending their team of cats into space. Each round, the commander chooses which of their cats will lead the mission. Each of their cats has a special ability. Then, in turn, each other player will contribute one cat to the crew until the ship is loaded with one cat from each player. The commander then blasts off through a push-your-luck-style dice system. Once into space, you'll encounter various moons and planets, and if you go far enough, deep space. At each leg of the journey, players will have the option to disembark their cats from the ship, earning points in the form of cat toys for where they land. Progress is never guaranteed, though, and at any point, the commander's luck could fail and the ship could crash. Don't worry, though. Everyone gets their cats back, 9 lives and all that. The ship passes to the next player, who then gets to be the next commander.
This game does have some striking artwork and fantastic components, including one of the best neoprene mat-style boards we've ever seen first party.
Yeah.
Now see all this and more in our MLEM unboxing video on YouTube.
Yeah, that mat really is great, but it's long. So table size can be a concern here. I don't think it'd fit on like your standard fold-out card table. Now, the rest of the components do stick out as great as well. The dice, while they look like they're just D6s, and I would have sworn they were D6s until I did the unboxing video, are actually custom dice. The player boards are nice and thick cardboard instead of just card. The scoring tokens have these cool toy artwork on them. The bonus medals look like actual medals. And honestly, my kids are like, can we get some of these made in real life?
The rulebook is solid with lots of white space, tons of examples, and a great summary on the back of the book. It's also short enough that you could probably get away while reading it if someone else was punching the cardboard, so you can get the table right away. Get to the table right away.
Now, speaking of rules, here's an overview of how MLEM plays. You start by rolling out the playing mat and giving each player a player board and the 8 hat tokens in their preferred color. The starting player, who's the last player to clean the litter box, gets the ship board and the 6 custom dice. That's it. That's pretty much it for setup.
Each round, the player with the shipboard will pick one of their cats to command the ship. Then each other player going around the table will contribute one of their cats to the voyage. Each cat has a different ability that will affect the upcoming voyage.
So 3 of the cats are pretty simple to explain. They just score double points if they land on the feature that matches the cat type. There's a x2-point cat for planets, 1 for moons, and 1 for deep space.
If the ship blows up, any parachute cats can choose to land at the spot the ship crashed, if there's room.
The satellite cat lets the voyage start a little further up the launch track on the board. Now, having multiple satellite cats on the same voyage does do nothing. You either have one or you don't.
There's a plus or minus 1 cat that can choose to disembark from the ship at the spot it's on or at the spots just before or after the one landed on.
Then there's the 1 pip cat that can be used once, as if it was a die with 1 pip showing. Multiple 1 pip cats can be on the same voyage, but each one can only be used once. You flip them over to show this.
Finally, there's the nasty lose a die cat. When this cat disembarks, the current captain loses 1 die for the rest of the voyage, unless they were already on their last die.
Now, once everyone's boarded their cats onto the ship, the commander rolls the dice and then sorts them by matching sides. Now, these are custom dice. They include 1 rocket booster symbol, 2 pip sides, and 1 side each showing 1, 3, or 4 pips. You then compare the roll of the dice to what's shown on the current spot the rocket token is on the mat.
Only dice sets that match what is shown on the mat at your location can be used. Other dice should be placed on the mat, and then the commander picks which remaining dice to use. They can use any number of sets from 1 roll, but they must use a full set. So if you have 3 twos and you want to use them, you have to move 6. You can't move only 2 or 4. Now, once decided, you move the ship the total number of all chosen dice.
Now, any dice used for movement are then lost. We recommend passing them to the next captain to use when it's their turn. That is except for those rocket booster dice. You get to use those again, and their value ranges from 1 to 3 based on the symbol shown on the map.
If none of the dice rolled, including your available bonuses, match any of the symbols on the mat at your location, the voyage was a disaster. The cosmic failure marker is moved 1 on the track at the bottom of the map, and everyone still on the ship gets their cats back, except those with parachute cats, who have the option of landing those cats instead of getting them back.
Now, after each successful roll of the dice, everyone, starting with the captain, gets a chance to disembark from the ship. Each space on the board after the first 7 or so connects to either a number of moons or a planet. Each moon has a number on it that represents the points you'll get if you land a cat there, and each moon can only hold 1 cat. Planets, on the other hand, can hold any number of cats, but don't score until the end of the game, where it's awarded on a majority fashion.
In addition to moons and planets, the very end of the board features 2 spots representing deep space. If your rocket makes it to deep space, the first cat to disembark gets a special reward of 7 points, and everyone else earns 5. Now remember, when collecting points, to take into account if a 2x point cat was used.
Now note that if the current commander disembarks their cat before the other players, the next cat in line becomes the new commander, and the dice should be passed to that player, who now makes all further dice decisions on the voyage.
Note you don't pass the shipboard, though, as turn order isn't affected by the order the cats depart. Instead, after each voyage, successful or not, the shipboard is then passed clockwise, and that player becomes the new commander and picks which cat they will use first. They will roll all of the dice for the next turn, etc., throughout the turn.
Now, when disembarking their cats, players are also competing to earn medals. There are 4 of these, and they're awarded to the player who first accomplishes the goal on that medal. There's a medal for having cats on 4 moons, having cats on 4 different planets, having 3 cats on the same planet, and 1 for having 2 cats in deep space.
The game continues until a player has played all of their cats, or the cosmic failure token reaches the end of its track, which is 11 spaces long. Cats in the future have evolved to have 11 lives instead of 9.
Points are then awarded for each planet, and then players total their scores. The player with the most points wins.
Those are pretty much the full rules for a basic game of MLEM, a very straightforward push-your-luck dice game. Now, Rebel Studio has also included 3 variants in the rulebook of each, which adds a bit more strategy and player agency to the game.
So the UFO variant involves placing a UFO meeples token out in deep space and a set of randomized expedition tokens. At the start of each round, the commander will draw the top token from this stack. This will probably move the UFO closer to the start and will indicate what dice the captain will have for this voyage and a bonus they'll get.
Note that captain and commander are being used interchangeably here because Mo is used to the last game where we accidentally used commander or captain instead of commander, but there's commander and captain is the same in this game. Now, while you may not start with 6 dice, these bonuses are quite powerful and include things like being able to keep a set of dice after spending them, a free reroll of any number of dice or sets of virtual dice that can be spent as if you rolled those numbers during the voyage.
Now, the only other change is a new stack of UFO scoring tokens that start at 5, and there's 5 of them, they count down to 1. If the commander or captain can get their rocket to stop on the same spot as the UFO, they get to claim the top token from the pile.
Now, the next variant adds explorations to the game. This is a stack of exploration tokens, 1 for almost every spot on the board. You shuffle these and then draw 5 and place them on the appropriate spots. If a commander lands on one of these, they get a bonus, and then a new token is drawn. Bonuses include gaining 1 to 3 points, regaining a die, or warping ahead on the rocket track.
Now, the final optional rules are for secret missions. At the start of the game, each player gets a set of 4 tiles, each of which shows a single moon or one of the planets. Everyone chooses 3 of these to keep, and then will try to land a cat on each of these specific places. At the end of the game, they get bonus points for the number of the missions they completed, either 2, 5, or 10 points.
MLEM is exactly the kind of game you expect from Knizia, except that it looks fantastic as well.
Yeah, Reiner is known for thinky, math-based games that usually don't have much of a theme. The mechanics in MLEM fit that style perfectly. This game is all about rolling dice, figuring out your odds at each step, and then deciding if you want to push your luck or not. But remember, this is a family weight game good for kids. The odds aren't hard to figure out, and honestly, you don't really have to figure them at all if you just want to chuck the dice and have some fun.
Now, unlike Mo, I'm not a Knizia fan. These games generally don't do much for me. Yet I found this one, while certainly on the lighter side, was really a fun game, especially for that family vibe. While the theme and certainly the name is silly, the game isn't. It's straightforward and understandable.
Yeah, the dice system here is actually solid and very interesting, which comes about by not using standard D6 dice. The odds aren't always what you'd expect. And then there's the fact that the one side has rockets, and if you roll rockets often, but not always, when you do this, you can keep dice between turns. But the interesting part is the designer here put spaces where rockets don't work. So it's kind of interesting the way that plays out. And this all leads to a variety in how each actual voyage, each full turn plays out. Like sometimes you don't even get far enough to score any points. And then on the next run, with the exact same odds and dice and things in play, you find yourself in deep space, even though you totally planned on getting off at the first planet.
I think one of the biggest selling points of this game are those dice. If they were just D6, it would be more straightforward and obvious as to the odds, and it would become almost a simple betting game.
And then the entire system for disembarking and choosing which cats to send each mission is just interesting and fun. And the most fun part of this game to me is that it leads to this weird mix of semi-cooperative play, and then take that play like interchangeably, and you never know which it's going to be at the start of each round. And I find that so fascinating. Like some turns, everyone's all on board. Like, no, we're going to go as far as we can. We're going to go to deep space. I'm going to give you a satellite to make sure we get it there. I'm going to give you my one cat. I'm going to give you another one cat. And the last player's like, oh, I'm putting on my two times because we're going to make it this turn. And then the next time you go around, it's like, no, I'm going to use a takeaway, a die cat. I'm putting a parachute cat because you're not getting anywhere. And everyone's hoping the ship crashes as soon as possible. But then, of course, it doesn't crash and all the players are groaning because some lucky roll means the voyage went way further than they thought.
So that's only the base game.
Yeah. So this entire system gets much more interesting once you toss in the optional rules. And I had a feeling the first time I played the game, I'm like, OK, neat, push your luck, family weight game. But I want to get to those optional rules because I think that's where the pudding is going to be. And it is, in my opinion, because everyone you add adds more interesting decision points, ways to mitigate bad die rolls, and overall just giving the active player, the commander, more agency over what's going to happen. And I greatly appreciate that in this type of game. I think the average hobby gamer is going to want to toss those in right away, perhaps even including all three variants in your first game. And like when I taught the game to Sean, he had never played it before. I just threw it all at him because I figured he's played games before. He's going to get it. It's just more interesting when you're not just trying to go as far as possible, because without the expansions, generally, you just want to go as far as possible and score as high up on the track. With the variants, though, you do end up with a slightly longer game. There is more decision points. We've noticed we get further because there's a way to mitigate those bad rolls, and the scores do end up higher. And I think all of those are good things. That said, I do like that I still got that base game, right? If I bring it out to a barbershop bar game night and it's 10 at night, and most people are heading home and we decide to stay for another round, I don't want those optional rules.
Yeah, the fact that players are no longer simply optimizing for the furthest point when you've got those expansions in really shifts the game strategies, as you can no longer guarantee the same rationality as in the base game. And That's one thing that the Knizia games are kind of focused on. It's that rational, almost economic play.
Now, as for theme, honestly, I couldn't care less about cats in space. I admit it. I had to look up what MLEM meant. If you were here for our last live stream, I think you got to see us look up what MLEM meant at the during our after show. Now, my kids, on the other hand, they saw that and are like, oh, my God, there's a game called MLEM. It's about cats in space. Like I hadn't seen my kids as excited about a new game showing up on our porch or on our door than I did for this game. The only thing they're actually disappointed by is the fact Rebel Studio didn't send the Blep mini expansion. And yes, I had to look up what Blep meant too. Sorry, I'm old. Now, I have found out since that the Blep expansion is actually an FLGS only standalone expansion that you can only get if you pick up the game from local game stores. So yay for supporting your local store. Now, as for tying the theme to the mechanics, it's Knizia. It's a mathy dice game, but it is tied in through the artwork at least, and the multiple puns in the rule book. So that's kind of nice. Like, I love that the point tokens are cat toys. Something about that, I'm just like, that's awesome. The point tokens are cat toys. And you're going to upgrade your one ball of yarn for a fish toy for three. And like that fascinates me. I think that's really cool. And I love the look of the planets. Like, there's one planet's a ball of yarn, another's a scratching post. Mechanically, though, this is a Knizia game, and there's not a lot of thematic crossover. Like, honestly, I'd like at least give us 9 different cats. At least there's some tie into the theme there.
No, it's interesting. Even the player boards with their really nice thick cardboard are completely extraneous.
Yeah.
They give you a surface to put things on and some fun art with a hint of the player color, but that's it.
Even the rocket ship. You could just line up the cat tokens in front of any player. You don't need that rocket, but then you get this cool, nice big rocket that looks pretty. They even did a two-sided. I don't even know if you ever flipped the rocket, but it looks awesome on the other side. Like I said, artwork tie-in, fantastic. Thematic tie-in to mechanics, not so much. Overall, I had more fun with MLEM than I expected, especially once tossing in the variant rules. Like, honestly, I agreed to review this one for my kids. I thought they were going to dig it, and I was right. Like, I've never seen my kids so excited when a board game showed up. They both love it. Both kids love the theme. They were easily picked up on the mechanics and the probabilities involved. They all agree with me that they like the expansions. Though the youngest did fine, once we put in the third expansion, it got to be just too many chips and things to manage. So with her, we keep that one out. They both dig pushing their luck. And they are the type of kids that, like, everyone leans over the table when the dice are about to be rolled and they're like, you know, cheering or, oh, yeah, we did it. Keep going. The one that shocked me, though, was Brenda, my mother-in-law, who we tend to play with on weekend game nights, was particularly taken with this one. Like, she actually said, please bring this over next week, and noted something about having just the right amount of thinking required. Like, you have to think about what you're doing to play well. You never have to think too hard.
I found this game was something I could very much see playing over drinks with friends, especially just that base game, rolling some dice, moving along a track, and laughing at what did or didn't happen. And once you add in those expansions, though, it does become more of a thinking game, but not too much. I just might not want to manage all the extra components while I was relaxing.
Yeah, which is honestly what Genevieve's problem with the game was, I think. It was trying to remember which planet she wanted to land on while thinking about how far she wants to move. It was just a little too much. Now, the other thing I do feel I have to call out about this game, and this is a positive thing that I'm still baffled by, this game is ridiculously cheap for what you get. Like, the neoprene mat is one of the biggest contributors to the cost of the game, but also the amount of cardboard. Just like I showed it off in the review, I'm like, there's a lot of cardboard in here because there's tiles and tokens and player boards on a rocket ship and scoring counters. And then the fact it's custom dice. These aren't just, you know, standard factory D6s that are in here. These are screen printed dice. And there's even like gold UV spot coating on the box for those who enjoy that kind of thing.
Honestly, the price point almost seems like a mistake, but apparently it's not.
Oh, I have to assume they printed a lot of copies or something. I don't understand. Like, this is a $30 US game. That's it. So if you dig push your luck games, especially dice driven ones, you're going to love MLEM. It has that. It feels like a Knizia game. You can tell it was well designed. It was play tested. The mechanics have probably been rattling around in his brain for 10 years before he put it down. It's a Knizia game without any of the brain burn, though. You can play it quick and furious, or you can take your time figuring out the odds, and both ways are just as fun.
Fans of the old Sid Saxon Can't Stop will likely love this one as well.
Now, MLEM was published with families in mind. Rebel Studios has produced a bunch of family weight games, and I think this fits that family game night genre perfectly. It's super quick to set up, which is something you don't have to worry about with kids, and you get playing right away. It's simple enough to teach and play that even younger kids should get it, but it's also engaging enough with enough hard decisions that even the most experienced hobby gamers can have fun playing it.
Which is especially true if you toss in the advanced rules.
Now, if high randomness, push your luck style games aren't your jam, you can probably avoid MLEM with a clear conscience. These style of dice games aren't for everyone, and even if you play the odds perfectly, that doesn't mean you're going to come out on top.
This isn't chess or Go or even checkers. You live and die here by dice rolls.
Now, of course, there's also those people out there that just love cats and will want anything cat themed. And for them, all I have to say is, well, we probably had you at Cats in Space, but sleep well knowing you're also getting a very solid game and not just a cute theme.
Well, our roles were good and we had the right crew, so we've managed to pull off another successful game review. What we would love to see next are some comments letting us know what your favorite Push Your Luck games are.
Now, if you don't care to comment here, feel free to hit me up on social media where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word. You can send me an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com.